days, O Lord, all the days, O Lord, I will worship you. Lord, we thank you. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Amen. Please take your seats. All right, we welcome viewers across the nations, all around the globe, wherever you find yourself this day. This is Liberty House International Church, all the way from the USA, coming to you live via Facebook and YouTube. In case you missed any portion of this broadcast, please go to our webpage, libertyhouseusa.org. Once again, libertyhouseusa.org. Hallelujah. Amen. Okay, my mind shifted for a second. We appreciate you for partnering with us, studying with us. It's very, very important that we study the Word of God, and we thank you for doing that. And please share. Like I always say, it's not about numbers. We want to get people out of bondage into truth. We stand, one of the things we say, our slogan is, we are demonstrating God's love and power. We are changing lives through God's Word, or transforming lives through God's Word. Hallelujah. Amen. The messenger of the Lord Jesus Christ, an agent of change and transformation, and always with the message of transformation. My delivery is a bit strange, or it's not conventional. Hallelujah. I'm talking about what is not popular. So please bear with me. In case I say something that you don't understand or doesn't go down well with you, please, let's not fight. I'm for you. I'm not against you. I'm not here to be condescending. I'm not here to degrade you or put you down. I'm here just to say things as he's giving me. I'm a messenger. Amen. So your life can be enriched. Amen. So you can be fulfilled. Amen. And you can fulfill your purpose on this earth. Hallelujah. Amen. All right, so let's turn our Bibles to the book of 1 Timothy chapter 4. Last Sunday, we touched briefly on that. And I want to finish that. So 1 Timothy chapter 4. Hallelujah. Amen. We are going to take it from, let's start from verse 1. So you are going to appreciate what Paul, what he was telling his son in the faith, that was Timothy. It says, verse 1, it says, now the Spirit expressly says that in the latter what? Latter times. Latter times, we are in the latter times. Some will do what? Depart from the faith. Some will depart from the faith, giving heed to what? Deceiving or seducing spirits and teachings of demons. It's going on. It is going on, seriously. And so sneaky, the devil is cunning. He was able to get Eve. And through that, Adam also was hooked. Now, in the same way, that kind of craftiness, that kind of crooked wisdom, he's still using, because he's still in the business of deceiving nations. And so what he does very well is he takes what is of God, what is scriptural, he puts a spin on it. He adds something to it. And if you are not a good student of the Word of God, what he adds to it, you may never catch it. Jesus caught him. He told Jesus, as Jesus was standing, he took him to a pinnacle, the Bible says. And he says, jump down. Because the scripture says what? You see, he was quoting scripture. The scripture says what? He will give his angels a charge over you, so you not dash your foot against a stone. Meanwhile, in that verse, it doesn't say that so you should go and stand on a rooftop and jump down to prove anything to anybody. He doesn't. But look at how beautifully he quoted the scripture. But Jesus was able to get hold of it. So he said no. He asked him to worship him, and he's going to give him all these things. He said no. He always said, it is written. It is written. Prove that you are the Son of God. And that brings us to what we're going to talk about. Turn these stones to bread. If you are the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. Jesus didn't have identity crisis. He knew who he was. So he didn't have to perform for anybody. He didn't have to impress anybody. He didn't have to prove to anybody who he is. His works spoke for him. Hallelujah. His words testified about him. And there were people who tested of his ministry and testified about him. Hallelujah. It says, if you don't believe me for the works that I do seek. So your works will always speak on your behalf. You don't need to prove anything to anybody. At times we waste our time studying and arguing with, I nearly said something. You don't have to argue with anybody. Let me say it this way. People who refuse to listen. People who refuse, they are not willing to yield their opinion to, as it were, hear something different than what they are saying. Then we waste our time trying to prove something to them. And talking about that, thank God for knowledge. Thank God for maturity. Thank God for, revelation. Because I used to do that. I mean, it bothered me when somebody accused me wrongly. It bothered me to the point that I would cry. When I couldn't cry because I was a grown man now, and I couldn't cry, I would do everything to prove to the person that, you know, what you're saying is not so. And I used to say something is, I wish, you know, I can cut my heart open for you to see what is the matter. Just to know that, you know, what you're thinking, what you're saying, it's not so. Look at me. You know, and I realized that, how many people was Jesus able to prove anything to convince them that he's the Messiah? How many people? Some people, you know, look at the scribes, the Pharisees, those who studied the law, including high priests and whatever. They should know better. But these are the people that really ganged up on Jesus. They didn't accept him. His own brothers didn't accept him. Some, it was after his death. Then they realized that, oh, that's the Messiah. See, when you know things like this, it helps you. That not everybody is going to accept who you are. Not everybody is going to validate you. But you know, that doesn't matter. When you receive validation from God, that is it. It's enough. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. You see, God has a way of, when he stamps his approval on you, he has a way of projecting you. He has a way of showcasing you. He has a way of bringing you from obscurity to the limelight. He has a way of doing it. He does it in grand style. You see, if you don't know these things, you'll be forcing. That's why some people are frustrated. Oh, I put in all this way, all this work. I've done all this. You know, I even went to see this person. I talked to that person, and they promised me this, and they promised me that, and everything has come to naught. You see, you're pushing too hard. You're your own effort. Paul said, by his grace, I am what I am. Hallelujah. Amen. And the labor, the works that I've done is still by what? His grace. That's what it takes. Let God make you. In Psalm 127, it said, except the Lord builds the house, life, the labor in vain that build it. And except the Lord watches the city, the work of the watchman, the security guard, is in vain. Jesus said, I, the Lord of the church, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. But we are trying hard to build our lives. And unfortunately, we are not building our lives based on the word. Because Jesus, in Matthew chapter 7, he says that he who hears my word and then he obeys it, I will liken him to a wise person who built his house upon the rock. You hear his word and you follow. You hear his word, you apply. That is one who has come into genuine, true, authentic what? Identity. If you are not coming into identity, as a child of God, as a son of God, then you do your own thing. Immaturity at times can also be there. Hallelujah. So the rains what? The rains came down. There was the flood. There was the wind. But the house, your life is still standing, not shaking. But it says, oh, the one who hears my word and doesn't apply it, doesn't make use of it, doesn't rely on it, is like a foolish one. Person, stupid person, Amplified says, who built his house on the sand. The same kind of challenges, the rain, the flood, the what? Wind, and then house, that house fell, that life collapsed. Great was the fall, Jesus said. Hallelujah. Amen. We have to build our lives on the word of God, because that is the solid foundation. That is the sure blueprint, the sure pattern to progress, to be productive in this life. He is the manufacturer. I mean, I haven't seen anybody who has done this before. You get your vehicle from a specific manufacturer, then instead of using the manual from the manufacturer, then you go and get a manual from another manufacturer with a different kind of vehicle, and then you are trying to use that to control what you have. Who has an iPhone? And then he goes to get another kind of whatever phone that is not iPhone or whatever. What is the name? Manual. Instructions book. That has nothing to do with the iPhone. And he's reading that instruction to what? Operate his iPhone. Who has done that before? Nobody does that. Have you realized? These people, they are something else. They know how to make money. That they know that when they make, you know, the phones, the upgrade and whatever. At times, you can use the earphone that you used to use or some small thing or whatever. You can't use it anymore. You always have to change something. I'm saying that to let you know something. That so if we forsake God, if we take God out of the equation, if we abandon his word, the blueprint, he's our manufacturer. He has a prescribed way he wants us to live our lives. If we abandon him, then we are looking for trouble. We are opening ourselves up for heartache, for disappointment, for disaster, confusion, for shame, name it, whatever. So I'm here this morning to encourage you, just don't go through life. Make sure you are hooked up with the Lord, your manufacturer. And make sure you follow his ways. Follow his word, not your opinion. Hallelujah. Amen. This is going on. And I have to say this. Some that were in good standing, I'm talking about spiritual leaders, they started well. They have a call from God. They were duly appointed, anointed by God. Now they have deviated. They are off. And because people don't know the word, even though these leaders are off, they are still being followed. Their teachings are being so what? Followed. And they have a lot of people following them. Hallelujah. Don't look at me strangely. King Saul, was he not the first king? Was he not anointed by a solid, God-appointed prophet, Samuel? And then what happened? He deviated. Now his business became killing people, suppressing people's gifts, standing in their way of purpose. And he started with who? What's the name? David. He came against his own son. I mean, what is this nonsense? But that is what is going on. You see, don't ignore the red flags. Don't ignore the marks. I like it the way, you know, it said in the Bible, New Testament, mark those who walk like we do walk. You have us for an example. Mark them. And also mark those who cause division in the body. Mark them. Avoid these people. See, so Bible gives us all the warnings. In Acts chapter 20, Paul was pleading with the elders. He was in tears. He said, I've been warning you that, you see, wolves, people are wolves that are clothed with what? What? Sheep, skin, whatever. Are clothed like sheep. From among you, they are going to arise and cause many to depart from the way. And that is what is going on. When the one who refers to himself as a spiritual leader, called by God, no matter the title he uses, when his motive shifts, I'll say that again, when his motive shifts from love, from the purpose of God, from the agenda of God, then he's off. Then he teaches and preaches just anything, and it's all about me, myself, and I. And therefore, he doesn't care anymore. The reverence for God is gone. The fear of God is no longer there. He doesn't have the respect that God has for people anymore. He doesn't have the compassion that God has for people anymore. He sees people as what? Things that he can use to get to what? His healing agenda. He abuses people. That is why they are so controlling. And now the manipulation, witchcraft in pulpits is very serious. Manipulation. And if you've not been taught, you don't know what manipulation is. Satan likes to control people. He's a slave master. God is gentle. He won't control you. He has given you what? Free will. He will tell you which way to go, but he won't push you. He will allow you to make, you know, the necessary kind of choice or selection. And this is going on. And it's amazing when you see a lot of people that are caught up in this kind of thing. Let's go to verse 2. Speaking lies. Speaking what? Lies in hypocrisy. No wonder now we have vloggers, we have sensational YouTubers, people like that have become self-appointed, and they are lashing out against some of these ministers. They are calling them out. So and so is saying this, so and so is saying that. I mean, the fear of God is gone so much that these people are able to contact some places and people they know how to contact and bring another kind of spirit into the pulpit. Speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron. That's what I'm talking about. You see, the Holy Spirit can't say a thing to them anymore. They become their own bosses. Bible says their belly is become their God. Stomach direction ministry, we call them. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Forbidding to marry, commanding to abstain from foods with God which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. All these things are going on now. Hallelujah. For every creature of God is what? Good. That's verse 4. And nothing is to be refused if it is received with thanksgiving. For it is sanctified by the word of God in prayer. That's simple. Hallelujah. If you don't want to eat something, you choose to eat it. You choose not to eat it, not because of religious kind of calisthenics reasons. Hallelujah. Verse 7. But reject profane and old wives' fables and exercise yourself toward godliness. For bodily exercise profits what? Church, talk to me. Bodily exercise profits what? Okay. Now, no, Bible is not coming against you going to the gym or you exercising. So don't read this and say, I know. No wonder I've not been feeling it. You know, going to the gym is so difficult. Exercising is so difficult. I understand. No, get a little that it profits you. That's what Bible is saying. All right? But godliness is profitable for all things. Balance is the key to life. So don't be so dedicated. The way people are dedicated to the exercises, if they are dedicated to God and to his word, studying, reading of his word, I mean, the world would be so, so, so nice, so fine-tuned by now. Having promise of the life that now is and of that which is to come. So godliness profits so much. Okay. So let's jump to 11. These things will command and teach. He's talking to his son, spiritual son, or son in the faith. Paul with his experience. Remember, Paul used to be a Pharisee. He was a follower of Moses. He was into the Mosaic. He had a relation of Jesus Christ. He became a follower of Jesus Christ. And what things he experienced, he's telling his son. So it says, teach these things. Verse 12, and let's read together. Hallelujah. Read. Let no one despise your... You're not reading. I think I'm reading alone. Let's try it again. Read. Let no one despise your youth, but be an example to the believers in word, in conduct, in love, in spirit, in faith, in purity. Hallelujah. This is, we're going to talk about purity. Purity, people think purity is when they are having their so-called worldly programs. Excuse my language. Then they decided to adorn themselves in white garments, then they are pure. You can wear the white garment and your heart is far away from truth. Hallelujah. Amen. Let no one despise you. It means that you can allow people to despise you. Hallelujah. Amen. For somebody to despise you, that's their choice. But for you to allow that to take ground, to take root in you, that is what? Travesty. That's a no-no. The responsibility is yours. God is not saying, I'm going to stop people from despising you. I'm going to stop people from looking down on you. I'm going to stop people from thinking less of you. I'm not going to stop people to think against you. I'm not going to stop them. But don't allow that to affect you. Do you get the same amen to that?
Amen.
Don't allow that to get to you. So we said last week, to despise is to think against. That is disesteem. It's to look down on. So people will do this. You don't have control of what somebody thinks, what somebody says. The impression that the person has about you, you don't have control over that. But what you have control about or control of is you. Your own thoughts. Your own life. Hallelujah. Now, whenever somebody is being ugly, they are despising you, they are looking down on you, they are thinking less of you and all that. The choice is yours. Hallelujah. How you respond is under your authority. I'll say that again. When somebody is being ugly to you, looking down on you, despising you, or what have you, how you choose to respond, you own it. You can go along with the person and then what? Encourage his foolishness, or you can refuse his foolishness and stand your ground as a wise person that has a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And so then you refuse what they are doing, you reject what they are singing, and then you say the word of God in their face and over your life. Do you get it? You say what God has said about you, not what they are saying. Because you have to say the same as what God has said. That's it. So anything that is contrary to what somebody is saying about you, some of the things about you, you don't take it. And I don't know if I should go into this now. I didn't want to, but I may go into that. Words. In Proverbs 18:21, it says that death and life are in the power of the tongue. So somebody can kill you softly by their words. They are suffocating you. You know, by their words. Somebody can what? Pep you up. Somebody can build you up, encourage you, make you come alive, get all excited through what? Words. Somebody can make you walk in sorrow. You go to bed, and instead of enjoying your bed, you'll be thinking about the words that they spoke to you. Words are containers. That's why Jesus said, the words that I speak to you, they are what? Spirit, and they are life. Or they are life, they are spirit. We speak the life. Spirit. So at times, when people are around you, and this happens. Now, I want to say this very well. Not anybody and everybody that says something negative to you or something contrary to you is being used by the devil. At times it's said out of ignorance. It's coming out of a deep concern and love for you. And yet because they are ignorant of truth, they are negative. Now, then on the other hand, there are those who are being propelled. They've been organized by Satan. And so they come. And what they are doing, they may not even know, some also know, they may not even know, but Satan is using them and speaking what? Through them. And that is the type that when you hear, if you are in tune and you are sensitive to the Holy Spirit, you realize that some holy kind of anger is going on through you. You just can't stand what is being said. You are troubled in your spirit. You are vexed. You are annoyed in your spirit. Just like what happened to Paul in Acts chapter 16 and 10 and rebuke the lady with the spirit of divination. Each time you feel something like that, go with the impression of the Holy Spirit and rebuke the spirit behind the words that are being spoken to you. Because at times we act like, oh, no, you can't say this to me. You are trying to fight, not the good fight of faith, but you are trying to fight in the natural. But the Bible says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. You say all that, then you leave the scene. The president is gone. Then you are walking alone. Then, oh my God, I can't believe you said that. But look at me. Am I that? Am I this? So, why are they coming? Why is this? So, then you realize that this word is eating you up. The spirit behind it is working on you because words are what? Spirit. It can carry a negative spirit or carry what? A positive spirit. Now, on the other hand, people can dish out these things to you. We'll talk about your response. But the worst of all is you yourself despising yourself. No disrespect to any woman who has been abused. But before, have you realized, before abuse really takes place, husbands abusing their wives, before it takes root, look at their strategy, the tactic, the technique. Like, oh, what is it a chicken that does that, the way they peck, they'll come after you. They'll say this little thing against you. They'll say another little thing against you. They'll come against that. And they come against that. And then when at times you stand your ground, then they say, I love you. I'm only just doing this. And then, they turn around, manipulate it. And before you realize, your self-worth, your identity is being what? Affected. And then now you yield to their control. And you forget that you are even a child of God. You know the things that are being done to you, they are not right. You don't have to what? Succumb. You don't have to yield. You don't have to agree with that. You have to stand up against that. But now, you have lost your identity. You see, they started despising you. And you did not stand up. And you allowed that to take place. Now you are looking down on yourself. By their words. By their action. So you look down on yourself. And then, okay. I mean, some of them, they didn't say things like, You think any guy out there will love you, will want you, but yet they want you. So abuse comes in all forms. That's all I want to talk about. But emotionally, they affect you. Financially, they affect you. Mentally, they work on you. They distance themselves from you. They begin to starve you in other ways. creating some kind of dependency on them. They stripped you of your connections, people that are in your life that will build you up, that will strengthen you. They strengthen, they disconnect you from all these things. You find yourself alone. Then you see yourself even talking against things that you believe in. Sound values. Bible-based values. Belief system. Before you realize you are talking against all these things. And always cutting them slack. You know, he's a good person. Just, I don't know, sometimes something comes over him. Do you know that something? And if you say, you know, but I love him. He loves me too. You know, just that. Do you understand love? You see what's going on? They don't even understand love. They don't understand commitment. They don't understand affection anymore. This is what goes on. For the enemy to play you like a soccer ball or throw you around like a football, this is what happens. He uses people to despise you. The moment you accept that, that's it. Hallelujah. People walk around with their heads down. I mean, they can be smiling, but within is like, why am I even smiling? I'm defeated. I'm a loser. You know, people look at themselves that way. Seeing yourself the way God sees you is very, very important. Hallelujah. And saying that, let me take you to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23. Kata kalibro kashtaya mandala. Last week, we looked at John chapter 1, 12 and 14. As many as receive him, to them give he the power to become children of God. And 13 says, we are born not of the will of man. We are born of God. Look at this. And I want you to get this. Let's read together. Read. Please don't use your indoor voice. I want you to use your crusade voice. When you get excited, the way you talk. Hallelujah. Let's do it. Read. Having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. We are born again, Bible says. Right? We are born again. So we are born of the word. Who is the word? Jesus Christ. God. You are born of God. And when a goat is born, it's born of not a cow. It's born of what? A goat. So we are... I want you to see the root of your identity, the root of your words, the root of your value. You are born of God. Let's have it in the, what do you call it? The Amplified Version. Hallelujah. Amen. Read. You have been regenerated, born again, not from a mortal origin, seed or sperm, but from one that is immortal, by the ever-living and lasting word of God. Hallelujah. This is where it's coming from. We are born of God. Now, so Jesus said in John chapter 3, let's go there. He that is born, so there's a natural, which is through what? Spermatozoa, or what we say, sperm. God's word is also what? A seed. But you have your first one, which is natural. Now, you being born again, you are born from above. So, John 3:3. We are born from the word, the seed, the sperm of God. Just like Jesus was conceived. The same way, I want you to understand this. The same way Jesus was conceived. His conception was spiritual. The Holy Spirit came upon Mary. The power of God overshadowed, you know, her. The same way we are also born by the word of God. The seed. Jesus answered him, oh, let's go to, okay, let's read this since it's there. Let's read together. Jesus talking to Nicodemus. Read. Jesus answered him, I assure you, most solemnly, I tell you that unless a person is born again anew from above, he cannot be acquainted with and experience the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Let's read on. So we've been born again. We are born from above. So look at this question. He's still talking about Nicodemus, natural things. He didn't understand what Jesus said. This version. Read. Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born again when he's old? Can he enter?" Oh, this guy is so natural. Can he enter? He has a point. You know, when you are born, you are tiny. So how now you are big? Can he enter his mother's womb again and be born? Verse 5. Let's continue. Read. Jesus answered, "I assure you, most solemnly, I tell you, unless a man is born of water and even the Spirit, he cannot ever enter the kingdom of God." Do you get it? Now 6 is going to shock you. Let's read. What is born from the flesh is what? Flesh. So the natural kind of bread. Of the physical is what? Physical. And what is born of the Spirit? So we being born again, we are born of the Spirit. We are born of God. Let's go to 1 John chapter 5, verse 4. For whatever is born of God is victorious over the world. And this is the victory that conquers the world, even our faith. Let's look at John 4:4. Is that, I'm sorry, 1 John 4:4. I'm sorry. That was my mistake. Okay. This is so what? Sure. It's so clear. Let's read. Little children, you are of God. You belong to Him and have already what? Defeated and overcome them, the agents of the Antichrist. Because he who lives in you is greater, mightier than he who lives in the world. Let's have the King James, New King James Version. Hallelujah. You are of God. You are born of God. Hallelujah. You are of God. You are born of God. That's your identity. As many as receive him, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God. That's John 1:12. To become. So you have become. If you are genuinely born again, you have become. Okay. So at times when people look down on you, they are looking at your social status. Two of us. They are looking at your social status. They look at, oh, who your parents are. They look at what? Oh, you, where you live. And stuff like that. What work you do. And stuff like that. Never allow yourself to be defined by the work you do. Hallelujah. Amen. You see, it takes a man who acknowledges greatness in them to serve. I'll say that again. It didn't go down well. I said it takes a person who acknowledges the greatness in them to serve. Because Jesus said, "He who wants to become great among you, chief among you, let him what? Let him serve." And Jesus was great. He is great. So he took upon him the form of a servant. And he served. He came not to be served, but to serve. That is Matthew 20:28. Your acknowledgement of the greatness in you. God. You see, you say greatness because God is in you. Hallelujah. God is in you. God is in union with you. God is one with you. God has made you his heir. God has made you joint heir with Jesus Christ. That's your value. That's your worth. That's your identity. Hallelujah. And that defines your purpose also in life. No one can define your purpose. It's the manufacturer that determines the purpose of the product that he has manufactured. Amen. So God who manufactured you, God who created you, is the only one who what spells out, qualifies the kind of purpose that you have. Hallelujah. Let people say all that they want to say. Don't take that bit. You don't look down yourself. Don't despise yourself. So at times we are going back to 1 Timothy chapter 4. He said, you look so much at your situation. Oh, I wish my parents gave me this. I wish my parents did this for me. I wish, you know, when I was married, I did this. You see, my marriage cost everything. Oh, when I was in school, this happened, that happened. Oh, when I lived with so-and-so, this happened, that happened. Oh, I remember my former church, and this happened, that happened. And, I had this good friend. I thought it was a good friend, but this and that happened. You see what I'm talking about? Experiences, circumstances, situations. Oh, I found even bankruptcy before. Oh, my car has been repossessed before. Then you allow these things to weigh heavily on you. Turn this energy towards the word of God. Hallelujah.
Yes, amen.
Turn this energy towards the word of God. Set the direction down. Shoot for another direction. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yes.
What is that direction? The word of God. Go towards God. You are going down the wrong lane. The word of God will begin to pep you up. Look, I've been doing counseling for all these years. And normally when people come to you, at times, slight things that happen remind them, slight things, petty things. You know, they are reminded of their what? Negative experiences. And if they've not been dealt with it well, then all of a sudden they are reliving the past. That is why I don't have to look at circumstances. The Bible says, why we look not at the things that are seen, but the things that are what? Unseen. Look at the word of God. Hallelujah. I was going to read this, but let's go to Philippians 4. Verse 8. Hallelujah. Philippians. Let's have it in the New King James. This is too tiny. New King James. And let's read together. Are you ready to read? You haven't even clapped once for me. Wow. Doesn't mean I'm doing a poor job. I didn't have to ask you to clap for me. You're supposed to know that I have to clap for me. That encourages me. So, I do that so those who are trying to sleep, they won't sleep. Okay. Let's read. Read. Finally. Wait. The word finally, what does it mean? Finally. When all is said and done. Finally.
Yeah.
Let's keep the main thing what? The main thing. Read. Finally, brethren, whatever things are what?
True.
So what is true? The word of God. Whatever things are what? The ugliness that someone dish out to you. The negative experience. That wasn't noble. It was a rascal. Who doesn't know who he is? See, Dr. Miles Monroe said it this way. When you don't know the purpose of a thing, abuse is inevitable. I'll say that again. When you don't know the purpose of a thing, abuse is inevitable. So the person that is dishing out, they are dishing out to you. I was going to say knucklehead, but I can't say that. That's why I use the word rascals. Rascals. You know, so they don't see your worth. They don't see your value. They are not God. They didn't create you in the first place. That's why they are saying what they are saying about you. They are limited in their perception. See, so that wasn't noble. If the person was noble, they would have handled you in a noble way, with dignity. But they didn't. Okay, whatever things are what? Just. Come on, when I get it, tell me. Whatever things are what?
Just.
The next, whatever things are what? Pure. What is purer than the word of God? Your situation is not pure, it's subject to change. The Bible says it's temporal. Hallelujah. Whoever was saying whatever they said to you and they are doing whatever they are doing to you, they are not just. They are not God. God is the only just one. Focus on Him. Then the next one, whatever things are what? Lovely. Why do we fixate on things that are not lovely? Why? That is one of the ways we despise ourselves. We look down on ourselves. You say things like, me, I can't stand before people. I'm shy. Who is the you that you are talking about? The one that is created, is born again, or the one that your mother gave birth to? I don't mean sarcastic. In the natural, we can say we have this, we have that. But when we talk about we being born again, grace that we have received, the empowerment, is totally different. Do you get it? It's different. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. You didn't have any college education. You didn't have any high school education. So what? God calls you and makes you noble. I know putting down education, but God can use you regardless. Hallelujah. So he says, what things are all of a good report? If there is any virtue and there is anything praiseworthy, meditate. It means think on these things. You see the discipline that we have to walk on? We have to think. We have to meditate on these things. As I'm talking to you now, probably yesterday, if I should ask everyone to talk to us, what was your meditation? What are some of the things that you were thinking on? You get what I'm saying? So at times, we harm ourselves. We hurt ourselves. We sabotage our own progress. Do you get it? That's how we despise ourselves. We're always looking down on ourselves. I don't have this, I don't have that. He didn't say compare yourselves with one another. You have to know how God has wired you. What giftings, what abilities, what graces is given to you, and go to work. Okay, verse 9. This is very encouraging. Hallelujah. The things which what you have learned and received and heard and saw in me, these what? Do. Wow. That's a mentor speaking to proteges. And the God of peace will be with you. I've given you the blueprint. I've given you the powder. I've given you the instruction. Now all that you have to do, go ahead and do it. And then you are going to have what? The results. I always say this. If you know how to cook a specific meal, you can gather all the ingredients from any part of the world. You can bring that into your kitchen and you have the stove ready. If you don't begin to turn on the stove for you to have heat and to begin to mix the things the way you have to mix them and handle them the way you have to handle them, are you going to have your meal? No. That is what is going on in some circles with believers. Every ingredient is given to us by God. How to mix those things, how to put them together, it's been given to us. That's called knowledge, knowing. But how to do it is the problem. So it says, don't be hearers only, be doers of the word. You only do it, then you see it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Okay, now let me end. Let's go to the 1 Timothy chapter 4. 13 says, till I come, give attention to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. That's why I keep telling you, read the word, study the word. Hallelujah. That changes all right. Read the word, study the word. Meditate, give yourself to exhortation. Teaching is doctrine. The 14 says this, do not neglect the gift that is in you, which was given to you by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the leadership, eldership. I always tell people, you stay at the spiritual leadership that you respect, a spiritual leadership that you don't fight against, so you can receive. Because it's difficult to receive from, how should I put it? It's difficult to receive from a person that you don't respect. It's difficult. It's a spiritual principle. It's not going to happen. Hallelujah. Because you can't guard it, you are not open. So at times, I say this to my wife all the time. I can call people forward. And even though they walk towards me, I know they are not receiving. It's like you are giving Like you give injection and it's not going. He put the needle through, but he can tell that the medication, the medicine is not going. And then I said that over and over again. And then so when I realized that, I tried to work with the people to see if they are going to, you know, adjust. And I tell people not adjust. They stand here. I used to tell, I said, don't think that because people are in church, they are ready to receive. Don't think that because they walk forward, they are ready to receive. They're not. They stand and their mind is on something else. Their mind is not receiving. It's not in the receiving mode. Probably they are guarded. Oh, what is this guy going to say to me now? Okay, what is he going to pray about? Am I going to fall too? There are people here, am I going to fall? You see, all these things are going on. And if I fall, how am I going to fall? And what will people think? Will they say I have a demon? And whatever. This goes on with people. So they can't be attacked. It's like ready to fight. Fight who? And fight what? You know, they are not ready to receive. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They are mighty through God to the pulling down strongholds. So things are in people's mind that we have to dislodge. Stronghold, thinking kind of pattern, mindset. If you don't dislodge it with the word of God, you're going to rob yourself. And that makes you neglect what is in you. When you have identity crisis, you will never come into knowing the abilities that you carry, the graces from God, the giftings from God, the very anointing on you, you will despise, you will neglect. And to neglect means to make light of. Wow. Be negligent. Not regard. To be careless of. You know why I'm talking about this? The way you are going to prosper is through you acknowledging these gifts and working with them. The way we impact lives or we affect people, we help them realize their destiny. Is through we using these gifts. If you are going to make money, it's through these gifts. I'm not saying so now you say, oh, now I'm going to work on the gifts because I'm going to make money. I want money. No, 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 no. It's secondary. We use the way we love is through these giftings God has given us. The first thing, the way we love is through using these giftings. But I'm saying this because Bible says when Jesus walked in love and laid down his life, he's now as exalted above everything and every name. You see? Because he first loved, he laid down his life. What did he use? His giftings, his abilities. So don't neglect them. Don't do it. Hallelujah. Take what you have, begin to use them. And then you see the money follow. Hallelujah. Now, I can talk about this. I don't charge, you know, from what? Years. I don't charge anybody for ministering to them because freely have I received, freely do I give. Amen. But each time I minister, let me not say each time, by ministering to people, they see the benefits, reaping the benefits of ministry, they in turn turn and sow into my life. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. So the money you are looking for, probably it's not the way you are looking at it. Acknowledge the gifts of God in you. And first and foremost, you want to use them to enrich lives. Amen. You don't look at, this one looks like money. If I minister to them, they may give me this one. So I'm going to try to minister to them. You know, so I'm going to use my gift on them. Some people do it that way, but don't do it that way. Anybody God wants you to minister, use those gifts. And it's God who will reward you. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. You have no idea how powerful you are. Gideon did not know what he was carrying. He didn't. And some Christians are like that. They don't know because identity crisis has hit them so hard. Even though they are children of God, they sing all these songs. We are heirs of the Father and I'm a child of God. And this, they sing it. I'm blessed and highly favored. Yet, they have identity crisis. And so they come to church service. They sit down. They don't want to do anything. And for years, they've been coming, walking in and out of services. And some spiritual leaders are a contributing factor to what I'm talking about. They don't teach them to know what they have. They don't teach them. They don't create any room for them to exercise what they have. That's here why we push people. We want everybody to be up and doing, to function in their calling, to function in the grace that God has given them, to function in their ministry. So we call upon everybody and everybody to do something. I don't do everything by myself. But you go to other places. No. The person even is saying that, look, me, I'm the only person that can do this because I'm anointed. You see, because he's insecure, he has identity crisis, and his motive, probably his agenda, is money. So the more you depend on him, the more money he makes out of you. And unfortunately, that has become the norm. So preachers like me, messengers like me, teaching truth, when people are fighting us. Because you see, the negative mindset, the stronghold is already created. We are saying things that are simple according to the word of God. It's too simple. Oh, I don't have to fast. I think I have to fast for 3 days before I can get over this. Then you are saying, believe the word of God and you get it. Oh, you don't have to pray this long to get it. Believe the word of God and get it. Oh, I don't have to sow any seed. And I have to just take the word of God as it is, and then it works. They don't like that. They want you to put them in bondage. So some spiritual leaders, they'll say, you have to give me money so I can do a fast for you. I need to buy this and buy that so I can break my fast with that. So give me. No, it's going on. Seriously, people do that. Or they charge you. So before you even talk to them, they call that consultation fee. They say, when you go to the doctor, don't you pay copay and stuff like that? They will take money before they minister to you. Hallelujah. Amen. Don't neglect the gift. Meditate on these things. It says, give yourself entirely to them. Give yourself entirely to them. That's what I say to you this afternoon. Give yourself entirely to the Holy Spirit, to the giftings. Just like you appreciate me. I'm using myself as an example. You appreciate the giftings, the grace, the abilities that I bring to the table. I have given myself entirely to these things. I've acknowledged them. And so you have to do the same. Hallelujah. And you are saying this house, people that never saw themselves doing things, and now they are doing things. They move in the power of the Holy Spirit. They move the manifestation of the Holy Spirit. You see, that is what it is. Now, it's not just in this building. You have to take it outside. It can happen at your workplace where you are using these gifts to touch people. It can happen on campus. You are using these gifts. Like I always tell those who are in the medical field, I said, don't just be there, you know, like a robot. No insult. Like a robot. And just, oh, we go through that. Be aware of the Holy Spirit that resides in you, the giftings that you have, and speak life in that environment. Speak life to the patients, the people that you are attending to. Because some of them, at times, science cannot help them. You speak life. You allow your giftings to go to work. Marry the natural and the spiritual. Hallelujah. And I'll tell you this. When somebody is pronounced to die, they've been given 3 days, 2 weeks, a month to die. Then you minister to them. As a lay person as you allow the gift of God, the Holy Spirit, to work through you and touch your life. They don't mind. They will take all the money they have in their bank and give it to you. Yes. It happens. Not like all the money, but I'm saying they really appreciate what you have done. Because money cannot buy life. Hallelujah. Amen. Shall we rise? So I end by charging you the words in Galatians chapter 5, verses 1 and 13. Stand firm in the liberty wherewith Jesus, the anointed one, has made you free. And do not again be entangled with the yoke of bondage, but by love serve one another. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Thanks for tuning in. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you.